In this chapter, Heredity and Evolution, you will acquire knowledge about heredity and the various evidence put forward to prove the process of evolution, especially of human beings. The process of transfer of physical and mental characters from parents to the progeny or the offspring is called heredity. It is the transfer of biological characters from one generation to another via genes. Now, chromosomes are present in the nucleus of cells, and these chromosomes carry heredity characteristics in living organisms. The DNA molecule consists of two helical strands made up of deoxyribose sugar, phosphoric acid. This blue structure on both sides of the DNA molecule is a sugar phosphate backbone for the DNA molecule. And DNA is also made up of nitrogenous bases like adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine. Adenine always pairs up with thymine, guanine with cytosine. Now, the study of heredity is very useful to diagnose, prevent, and treat heredity disorders. Also useful to produce hybrid plants and animals, and also used in industrial processes which use microbes. Differences between DNA and RNA. DNA, called deoxyribonucleic acid. RNA, only ribonucleic acid. DNA is a double helical structure, whereas RNA is a single structure formed from the double structured DNA. DNA has four nitrogenous bases called cytosine, guanine, adenine, thymine. RNA also has four nitrogenous bases, three of them being similar to that of DNA, that is cytosine, guanine, and adenine, and thymine here in RNA being replaced by the nitrogen base called uracil. The three types of RNA. First type, messenger RNA or mRNA, which carries the code from the DNA to the ribosome for protein synthesis. Next, we have the ribosomal RNA or rRNA, which gathers together the amino acids brought by the tRNA in a specific order as given by the mRNA and for making proteins. The last or the third RNA type is transfer RNA or tRNA. This tRNA transports specific amino acids to ribosomes for protein synthesis. DNA takes place in the process of protein synthesis, or it helps to synthesize proteins with the help of RNA. Information about protein synthesis as needed by the body is stored in the DNA. Now, these proteins are synthesized by DNA through RNA. This process is called central dogma. So the proteins that are synthesized by DNA with the help of RNA, that procedure is called central dogma. Now, one strand of mRNA, as you've seen in previously, one strand produced by the sequence of nucleotides on DNA. Now, when this one strand of RNA is synthesized. One strand of mRNA synthesized as per the sequence of nucleotides on the DNA. This synthesis is called transcription. Now here we see the ribosome. You see the sequence of mRNA. You see the ribosome has a large unit on top, a smaller unit down. Then we see the tRNA here and the process of formation of amino acids. The mRNA formed in the nucleus of the cell comes now into the liquid substance called cytoplasm of the cell, and it brings with it coded messages from the DNA. So the first step here is that the mRNA formed in the nucleus of the cell, it comes out into the cytoplasm and it brings coded messages from the DNA. Now these codes for amino acids, they consist of three nucleotides and is therefore called a triplet codon. And you see this here, GUG, CAC, AAU. So these are coming out as codes for amino acids, for the formation of these amino acids. So they are formed using codes made up of three nucleotides, and therefore each group of three nucleotides coming out in code as per the messages of the DNA is called a triplet codon. Now each mRNA strand, look at this strand here, is made up of thousands of triplet codons, and each triplet codon is made up of three nucleotides. Now as per the message in this mRNA, you can see there's a specific coding, specific way in which the nucleotides are arranged. So as per this message, amino acids are supplied by the tRNA. Can you see this tRNA coming in now? And it supplies to guanine, cytosine, to uracil, adenine, again uracil, adenine, and it complements the code or the triplet codons here. tRNA supplies the code there, okay, as per the message on the mRNA. And as per this message, amino acids are supplied by the tRNA. Now, for this, the tRNA has these anticodons. We have the triplet codon down here and the anticodon also in groups of three that have a complementary sequence to the codon on mRNA. You know, in the previous picture, I showed you that adenine teams up with uracil and guanine teams up with cytosine. And you can see clearly in this diagram here that tRNA brings a complementary sequence. Now, over here we have guanine. So guanine will only team up with cytosine. So this complementary sequence is brought by the tRNA, and this procedure now is called translation, where the tRNA supplies anticodons in a complementary sequence to the mRNA. Amino acids brought by the tRNA bond together by peptide bonds with the help of rRNA. During this process, that ribosome keeps on moving from one end of the mRNA to the other end by a distance of one triplet codon. Okay? One triplet codon meaning three nucleotides. Now, this process is called translocation. Living organisms can produce new individuals like themselves due to genes only, and some of these genes are transmitted to the next generation without any changes. Okay, due to this reason, because the genes, some of them are transmitted to the next generation without making any changes to themselves. There are absolutely no changes, due to which some of the characteristics of the parents are directly transferred to the offspring or to the progeny. So therefore, when we see the child, it resembles the parents in some ways, very clearly, because of the genes that are transferred without any changes. But sometimes sudden changes occur in these genes. Sometimes any nucleotide of the gene changes its position and causes a minor change, which is known as mutation. So sometimes this happens. We have these, and then suddenly the change takes place, and this is called translocation. And a brand new type of gene is transferred to the next generation. This process of change in the genes, minor changes, are called mutation. The differences between transcription and translation. Now, the DNA molecule is a double helix molecule. In transcription, as per the code of the DNA, a single strand of mRNA is formed, that is called transcription. This single strand of RNA, as per the coding of the DNA, now works to form proteins or synthesize proteins. That process is called translation. Transcription is the process of producing a strand of RNA from a strand of DNA. The information stored in DNA molecules is rewritten or transcribed into a new RNA molecule. And translation is the process where the information carried in mRNA molecules is used to create proteins. The specific sequence of nucleotides in the mRNA molecule provide the code for the production of a protein with a specific sequence of amino acids. So, transcription is a process by which genetic information encoded in DNA is copied onto messenger RNA. It occurs in the nucleus, and it is the making of mRNA from a DNA molecule. Whereas translation is the process by which information encoded in mRNA is used to assemble or synthesize a protein at a ribosome. Obviously, it occurs in the ribosome, and here mRNA synthesizes proteins. Lot of work has been done by scientists in this regard, that is heredity and evolution. And the name of the scientists who have done important work is Johann Gregor Mendel. He was called the pioneer of modern genetics, the beginner, the person who took it seriously first. Walter and Sutton paired chromosomes in grasshopper. They proved that there were paired chromosomes in grasshopper. Hugo de Vries put forward the mutational theory. Ostwald, Avery, Macklin, McCarthy, Colin MacLeod, they showed that DNA is present in all living organisms except virus. François Jacob and Jack Monod proposed a model for protein synthesis, and our very own Indian Dr. Hargobind Khurana is important because he discovered triplet codons for 20 amino acids. Now we come to the second part of the lesson, which is called evolution. Now, what is the function of the appendix in our digestive system? There is no known function of the appendix. Now, at 14 or 15, we do not have wisdom teeth and we are still chewing sugarcane, walnuts. We can break walnuts with our teeth. Okay. And later on in life, by 2021, we will start getting the last four teeth called the wisdom teeth. So, are the wisdom teeth really useful for chewing food? No. Now, we all get very excited to watch Jurassic Park and any information about huge animals called the dinosaur, who lived a crore of years ago. Now, they became extinct. People say because, you know, of the ice age, they didn't get food. And they also say that there were sudden changes in the habitat. Or another theory claims that there was a meteor which came down on Earth due to which dinosaurs became extinct. And many species of animals and birds are getting extinct or going away from the Earth. They are no more on the Earth because of changes in climate and change in their habitat, the place where they live, due to deforestation and many other reasons. Now, what is evolution? Evolution is the gradual change which occurs in living organisms over a long duration. Now, duration here doesn't mean 10 years or 15 years. It means crores of years. So this evolution is a very, very slow change through which the development of organisms is achieved. Any organism, be it human or any other, they develop slowly, and that is called evolution. The definition: formation of a new species due to changes in specific characters of several generations of living organisms, responding to natural selection, is called evolution. Now look at this, which shows you how man has evolved over crores of years. And today, man looks something like this. Started off from being an ape. And here in this GIF, you can see it very quickly. But this has taken crores of years. That is the evolution of man. The theory of evolution. Once again, we see in this GIF that man started from the first living material or protoplasm, something like this, which was formed or found in the ocean. After some time, a unicellular organism was formed out of that protoplasm. Changes occurred in the unicellular or one-cell organism from which larger complex multicellular organisms were formed. Now, these changes were very slow and very gradual and took approximately 300 crore years. Now, changes and development in all living organisms has been multidimensional. They grow not only in size, but they grow in many other aspects. And that has led to the evolution or the change for a new developed type of organism. This overall process is called evolution. And another way to describe evolution is the progressive developments of plants and animals from ancestors, great-grandfathers, having different structural and functional organization. Evidences of evolution. Now, I can show you any amount of pictures and tell you, you know, man evolved from ape or monkey to what he looks like today. But as you know, in science, proof is always required. and proof is always given to show some new concept. In the same way, a lot of evidence has been provided to prove the evolution, the theory of evolution. Now, if you look at this picture, all these three animals, they look different, but if you look carefully, you will find their nose and mouth in the same place. They've got hair all over their body. Eyes are two eyes in the similar place. See their ears similarly located. Similarly with the fruits, you see the similar type of leaves and the fruit, how it hangs. So just at one glance, we see that these animals and these fruits are similar. Now, this kind of similarity, which is visible and external, is called morphological evidence. What are these similarities? In the position of the eyes, the structure of the nostrils, the ear pinna, that's the muscle surrounding the ear, hair on the body, and in plants, it is the venation of the leaves, that is either parallel or reticulate venation, the shape of the plant as well as the leaves. And this proves that the origin of the plants and animals is the same. It proves that they had common ancestors. Anatomical evidences. Now, if you look at these four pictures, all four of them look different. Again, you will see that not only they are different, but they have different functions. So, when I look at the human hand, the foreleg of a cat, the flipper of a whale, and the patagium of a bat, not only they look different, but they use it for different things. You know what a human being uses his hand for? The whale uses its flipper for swimming, and the patagium of the bat for flying. But if you look clearly, there is a similarity in the structure of the bones and the bony joints of the organs. You will see two bones joined here, two bones joined here, after which they have the digits here too. Here also you will find two main bones being joined, and then there are digits. Similarly with the patagium of bat, two main bones being joined, and then there are digits. Okay, so this similarity indicates that though it is different now, these animals may have had a common ancestor. And the bones which prove that come under anatomical evidences. Another evidence is vestigial organs. Now, degenerated, not very well formed or underdeveloped, useless organs in organisms which cannot perform functions are called vestigial organs. Now, existing organs in any organism, they undergo very slow gradual changes to survive in a changing environment. Now, a specific structure, all organs, they undergo changes as per the need to survive in a changing environment. But a particular structure may be useful in certain situations, but with the change in environment, that organ may become useless or even harmful when the changes take place. Now, such a structure begins to degenerate as per the principle of natural selection. Means now, we don't require it. And so it starts to degenerate. It takes thousands of years for a structure to disappear. And they are seen in different phases of disappearance in different animals. Now, such organs may be functional in some organisms, but in other organisms, they are non-functional. They have no function. For example, the muscles of the ear pinna and the hair on the human body, they are not functional today, but they are functional in other organisms. Now, such type of organs are called vestigial organs. Some examples of vestigial organs are the muscles of the ear pinna, the muscles surrounding the ear, the appendix, which is this green structure, the lower end of the large intestine, the tailbone or the coccyx, and the last four teeth in the upper and lower jaw, which are called wisdom teeth. Paleontological evidences. You can see here, these were the remains of starfish, fish, and a dinosaur, which were discovered years later, due to which we had the idea of what the dinosaur looked like. Now, these were preserved in stone or under the earth and were found years later. Now, they are called fossils. When a plant or animal dies, the soft parts quickly decay or they are eaten up. Now, the hard parts such as the bones, the teeth, the shells, they last much longer and they become fossils. Many organisms existed millions of years ago and their secrets are hidden in the earth in the form of fossils. These organisms get buried due to flood, earthquake, volcano, etc. And their remnants of bones, teeth, etc. remain preserved, which are called fossils. And these fossils help us very much in the study of evolution. Now, paleontology is the study of the history of life on Earth based on the evidence they get from fossils. The structure of ground level and fossils. If you look at this picture, there are three main eras over here: Paleozoic era, Mesozoic era, and the Cenozoic era. Now, the Paleozoic era, during this era, arthropods, that is the spiders, the cockroaches, prawns, etc., mollusks, that are the snail, fish, and amphibians that lived both on land as well as in water, all came during this era. Okay, so here during this era, life began in the ocean, but eventually from the ocean it transitioned and moved onto the land in the form of amphibians. The next period, which spans about 252 million years ago to about 666 million years ago, it was also known as the age of reptiles or the age of dinosaurs, that is the Mesozoic era. And the last era, the Cenozoic era, is the third of the major eras of Earth history, beginning 66 million years ago, where the Mesozoic era ended. And it's going on till today. Now, this clearly shows you that invertebrates, now this is how they are, the fossils are found under the earth. Clearly showing you proof that invertebrates came first on the earth, followed by reptiles, and finally the vertebrates. Carbon consumption of animals and plants stops after death. And after death, only the decaying process of C14, carbon-14, occurs. Now, what is this carbon-14? Look at this picture. Cosmic rays bombard the upper part of the atmosphere. Okay? Now, these neutrons collide with the atmosphere, nitrogen atoms, producing radioactive carbon-14 or C14 atoms. Now, during life, plants and animals, they gain C14. And when they perish or die, their bodies decay and C14 is lost. So the death of an organism results in no gain of C14, but loss of C14 by decay. Now, in the case of dead bodies of plants and animals, instead of this C14 remaining constant, the ratio between C14 and C12 changes continuously, as C14 is radioactive, but C12 is non-radioactive. So, the time passed since the death of a plant and animal can be calculated by measuring the radioactivity of C14 and also the ratio of C14 to C12 present in their body. This is called the carbon dating method, the method to find out the time that the organism died. Now, this is used in paleontology, that is the study of fossils, anthropology for determining the age of human fossils and manuscripts. Once the age of fossil has been determined, it becomes easy to get information about other organisms. Okay, and it seems, according to these studies, that vertebrates have originated from invertebrates. Another evidence to prove evolution is called the connecting link. Now, organisms which possess the characters of two different groups are called connecting links. For example, peripatus. Okay. Peripatus has characters like a segmented body, segments all over his body, thin cuticle, and parapodia-like organs are present. These animals also show tracheal respiration and an open circulation system similar to arthropods. So they are similar to arthropods as well as annelids. Okay. So this indicates that peripatus is a connecting link between annelida and arthropoda. So basically, what's a connecting link? It proves the theory of evolution. A connecting link is something that is in between two groups of animals. Now, that lesson on classification of animals will come later, where you will learn these groups into which specifically animals are classified. Now, when an animal like peripatus is in between two groups, which are arthropoda and annelida, it shows us very clearly that it is in the process of evolution, taking many years. So it is moving on, it is developing from annelida and going towards the next group, which is arthropoda. And this kind of a creature, which is not having the characteristics of either group, but is in between, is called a connecting link. Next one is Neopelina. It's a connecting link between mollusca and annelida. Next, we have the lungfish. Okay. It performs respiration with the help of lungs. Okay. And it is in between amphibians and fishes. Virus, which is proved to be connecting link between the living and the non-living. Euglena, connecting link between plants and animals. And platypus is a connecting link between reptiles and mammals. So this duck-billed platypus, it lays eggs like reptiles, but it has mammary glands and hair like mammals. So very clearly, it's a connecting link and it is in the process of evolution. The next group of evidence is called embryological evidence. Now, if you look at this picture here, the fish, salamander, tortoise, chicken, rabbit, and human, in their initial stages, they look very similar. But as they grow, now this is the embryo, the embryonic stage when they are not yet born. But as they grow, you will find that the similarities, they decrease and they start looking different. Okay. Now, this proves that there is a same pattern here. By studying the same pattern in these vertebrate animals, all of them are vertebrates, we find evolutionary links between them, indicating that their ancestor was a common ancestor. Okay? So because all of them look similar in initial stages, it shows that they had a common origin or a common ancestor. And this is called embryological evidence. The theory of natural selection put forth by Charles Darwin. He collected many specimens of plants and animals, observed them, and then published his theory, which talks of survival of the fittest. Only the fit will survive. He says that all organisms, they reproduce very well, quickly, prolifically, and they compete with each other in a life-threatening manner. Now, those plants and animals that show modification needed for winning this competition to live, they survive and the rest of them die. Those who survive give rise to a new species having their own specific characteristics and the will to survive. Now, I give you a small example. When you are asked to germinate seeds, you put a whole lot of mustard seeds there and everything starts growing. That means they reproduce prolifically. Okay, then they start competing with each other in a life-threatening manner, and without you doing anything, you will find so many of these mustard plants, they start dying. And at the end, only a few of these plants will survive. This survival of the fittest was first published by Charles Darwin as the theory of natural selection. Now, this theory had some objections where it was said that natural selection is not the only factor to prove evolution, and that Charles Darwin did not explain about the useful and useless modification, and also did not explain about slow changes and quick or abrupt changes. Another evidence is called Lamarckism. Now, John Baptist Lamarck, the scientist, he had two theories. Okay, he said that the morphological or the visible changes taking place in living organisms are responsible for evolution. And the reason for these changes is the activeness. Either the organism is active or lazy. And this principle is called the principle of use and disuse of organs. And to prove this, he gave an example saying that giraffes had short necks. But when the trees started growing taller and taller, giraffes couldn't reach and they had to stretch their necks. Therefore, through a long period of generations, giraffes today have longer necks. He then said that there are acquired characteristics that organisms get, which are transferred from one generation to the other. And this is the theory of inheritance of acquired characteristics, or Lamarckism. Now, examples of acquired characters are the strong shoulders of an ironsmith due to hammering frequently. So the ironsmith may have started out by banging that iron, you know, in front of the fire, very heavy stuff, and so he has strong shoulders. According to Lamarck, he says that these strong shoulders which he got can be transferred to the next generation. He also gave an example of the weak wings of the ostrich and the emu. They don't fly, and so their wings have become weaker and weaker. On the other hand, the swan and the duck, they swim and they use their legs for swimming, so they have stronger legs. And if you look at this fossil, you will see this is a fossil of a snake. A snake previously had legs. But these legs came in the way of them burrowing into their holes. And so, because they didn't use these legs, they went away as the snake evolved. Okay? So, according to Lamarck, these characteristics which are acquired, like the weak wings, the strong legs and no legs, and the strong shoulders, can be transferred to the next generation, and it is called the inheritance or ancestry of acquired character. Speciation, another evidence of evolution. Speciation is the formation of new and distinct species in the course of evolution. So what happens is that if you take this example of this parkfish, it is separated by so much of distance, one in the Pacific Ocean and the other in the Caribbean Sea. And over the years, you will see that the parkfish has changed and having different characteristics in the Caribbean Sea and different characteristics in the Pacific Ocean. Okay, this is called geographical speciation because of the distance, the difference in the geographical features in Caribbean and Pacific Ocean. A new species has formed in the Caribbean Sea and new species in the Pacific Ocean. Now, geographical conditions lead to formation of a new species, either reproduction or geographical conditions. Okay, if you see here, there's a finch, and this type of finch now has a different beak. This one is different. This is for insect eating. This is for catching woodpeckers. Woodpecker. This is a woodpecker type of beak. Sorry, for insect eating. And this is a seed eating finch. So within the finches, see the formation of new species. Okay, so the formation of new species in the course of evolution due to geographical factors or reproductive factors is known as speciation. Human evolution. Human evolution is the evolutionary process that led to the emergence of modern humans, beginning with primates or ape-like animals, and leading to the emergence of Homo sapiens, or man as we know today, as a distinct species. You know, in that GIF I showed you earlier, we saw the man evolving from this type of a creature, an ape-like creature. And today, we have him like this and even better. Okay. Also, during the evolution, we find that this Australopithecus man had a smaller skull, that indicative of a smaller brain. Chimpanzee has a smaller brain than Homo erectus, or when man started standing straight, his brain also was smaller than the brain of man we have today. Evolution has gone on for 300 crore years, so we can't document every little thing that happened. So, the important stages are documented, and they are like this. 7 crore years ago, dinosaurs disappeared. Some lemur-like animals were present on the earth, and from them, ape-like animals, they came onto the earth. Around another important milestone, 4 crore years ago, we had Egyptopithecus. And these ape-like animals, the tails disappeared. Very important in the evolution of man, the tails disappearing. 2.5 crore years ago, we have Dryopithecus, where there is the evolution of the gorilla and chimpanzee in Africa. 1 crore year ago, we have Ramapithecus, the first human-like animal in East Africa. 40 lakh years ago, Australopithecus was the more intelligent ape of South Africa. 20 lakh years ago, we have skilled humans now having little skills. You know, human being has a lot of skills, but the skills started showing 20 lakh years ago. 15 lakh years ago, another big breakthrough in human evolution, man was now not moving on four legs, but started standing straight, having an erect posture. And they existed in China and Indonesia, that is the Asian continent. Then 150,000 years ago, we have Neanderthal man, who was the first example of wise man. 50,000 years ago, the Cro-Magnon man. And after this, evolution took place much faster. 10,000 years ago, wise man started practicing agriculture. 5,000 years ago, writing was invented, and therefore, because there was writing, the history started being documented. 400 years ago, modern sciences started. 200 years ago, a society like the type we live in today was started. And as you know today, man is evolving faster and faster and faster. So evolution is taking place much faster now than it was taking place 7 crore years ago. I put this to show you that this is the evolution of man from an ape to erect. And they are trying to show you that the more we have our mobiles and devices in front of us, we are going to probably end up like the first ape. Because our posture is getting lower and lower, and instead of now being erect man, we are losing our posture, and probably due to the technological advances, we will go back to this posture.